Hello, everyone. My name is Sergei Nikitenko. I am from the Institute of the Separation Chemistry of Marcoule. Our institute is situated in the south of France. And today I'll talk about the photothermal production of hydrogen. Production of hydrogen without CO2 emission is a key point of green energetics. Today, there is only one green technology available for hydrogen production. It's electrolysis of water. And about only 4% of global industrial hydrogen is produced by this technology. And this hydrogen is still too expensive. There are other technologies, emerging technologies like photocatalysis under solar light or photoelectrocatalysis. And the efficiency of these technologies depend on the performance of catalysts. And catalysts should be active under solar light. They should be stable. They should not be very expensive. It means that these catalysts should not contain noble metals. And the catalyst should not be toxic. So the good photocatalyst should meet very strict requirements. Another point is the efficiency of the photocatalytic processes. And we know now that introducing heat into photocatalytic process can significantly improve the photoconversion efficiency. That is why the photothermal processes attracted a lot of attention last decade. And as you can see on the diagram, the number of publications dedicated to photothermal catalysis grows very rapidly. Also, I show here some very recent reviews on this topic. But what the photothermal effects mean? In fact, this is a very complex phenomenon, which can be divided on three big groups. First, it's photodriven thermocatalysis. It means that light is used just as source of heat of catalyst. And then reactions are activated thermally at the surface of the catalyst. Another group is a joint effect of heat and light. Both can activate photocatalytic processes. Very often such kind of photothermal effects observed for noble metal, for catalyst with the noble metals. And the third part is thermal assisted photocatalysis. It means that principally activation occur by light, but application of heat can improve the efficiency of the photocatalytic processes. And today I'll focus on this kind of photothermal effect. So we studied as a catalyst, titanium, titanium oxide, core shell nanoparticles. These core shell nanoparticles can be prepared from commercially available titanium nanoparticles by sonohydrothermal treatment in pure water. Sonohydrothermal treatment has been developed in our laboratory. It means that simultaneous hydrothermal treatment and ultrasonic treatment. The graphical sketch of this reactor you can see on this slider, and you can see that ultrasonic horn is directly inserted inside the hydrothermal reactor. We obtained this titanium oxide core shell nanoparticles by treatment in pure water. At this slide, you also can see the high resolution TM images of our particles. On the left, these are initial titanium zero nanoparticles. And if we take a closer by ultramicro tomographic study of this titanium zero particles, we can clearly see that these particles are coated with passivating layer, which is enriched in oxygen. But we don't observe any crystals at the surface. Then, after the treatment, sonohydrothermal treatment, you can see clearly the appearance of the nanocrystals at the surface of spherical core metallic nanoparticles. And these crystals, according to our study, these crystals are titanium oxide anatase. The size of this titanium nanocrystals is about 10, 15 nanometers. And the core, metallic core, typically it's around 90 nanometers. Here you can see the XRD and XPS analysis of our products. On the left in the table, you can see the titanium zero nanoparticles composed of alpha titanium, metallic titanium, and some amount of titanium suboxide, which is most probably situated at the surface of metallic titanium. And we do not observe any crystalline anatase. When we start to heat the products, we can see that with the increase of temperature, first, there is disappearance. We observe disappearance of titanium suboxide and appearance of crystalline anatase phase. And after 160 degree, we also see the decrease in of the content of metallic titanium. XPX spectrum shown on the right of initial titanium zero nanoparticles confirms the presence of low oxidation states of titanium at the surface, but also it shows the presence of some titanium 4, which we do not observe by XRD. It means that at the surface of passivated metallic nanoparticles, there are some amorphous titanium 4, which is not observable by XRD. From this data, we can suggest the mechanism for formation of nanocrystalline TO2 shell. At the temperature lower than 160 degree, this shell is formed by oxidation of titanium suboxide and by crystallization of amorphous titanium 4. At the higher temperature, from 160 degree, we also observe oxidation of metallic titanium. As you can see at this slide, both titanium zero and titanium oxide nanoparticles are black. So it means that they absorb light in very wide optical range. Here you can see the optical absorption optical spectrum. For titanium zero, we observe very broad continuum from UV to near infrared range. This is due to the interband transitions in titanium, and we do not observe any plasmon band. It means that titanium nanoparticles are not plasmonic. When we consider titanium oxide nanoparticles, we also observe this very broad interband transition bands, but also there is a band gap at around 308 nanometers, typical for anatase phase. And also on the right, you can see the photoluminescence spectra. So pure titanium oxide anatase phase exhibits a photoluminescence band around 360 nanometers, which is due to the electron and hole recombination process. However, with titanium oxide core shell nanoparticles, we do not observe this emission band. It means that there is efficient charge separation in core shell structure. Photocatalytic hydrogen production. We started using aqueous glycerol solution, glycerol as a sacrificial reagent. And we used argon flow thermostated reactor, which you can see here. As a source of light, we use a xenon lamp with anti-ozone coating, which provides mostly visible and near infrared light, and small contribution of UV light also. And the products, gaseous products, have been analyzed using mass spectrometry. And we analyzed the outer gas. At this slide, you can see some results about photocatalytic hydrogen production. On the left, you can see the hydrogen emission plots with titanium oxide nanoparticles uptake at different sonohydrothermal temperature. And you can see that if the content of titanium oxide is low, we almost do not observe the hydrogen. However, with the increase of the titanium oxide content at the surface of titanium, metallic titanium, we clearly see emission of hydrogen. And you can see also that when we increase the temperature, the production of hydrogen increases. And when we switch off the light at high temperature, we do not observe any more hydrogen. It means that we have a really photocatalytic process, but enhanced by temperature. And we can calculate the apparent activation energy, and it's about 25-31 kilojoule per mole. And this activation energy is much lower than activation energy of the chemical bonds. This is important for understanding of the nature of the photothermal effect. Also interesting that in the outlet gas, in the presence of glycerol, we do not observe emission of CO2, CO, or methane. So we observe emission only of hydrogen. However, what we see the acidification of our solution during photolysis. It means that, as it's shown at this scheme, that glycerol during photocatalytic process transform it to some organic acids without CO2 emission. What is also interesting that at high temperature, we can observe hydrogen even without glycerol. At room temperature, there is no, we do not observe. However, if the temperature reach 90 degrees, we observe photocatalytic formation of hydrogen in pure water. Of course, the yield, if we compare, is lower than with glycerol. However, it's an interesting observation. Our data allows to suggest some origin of the photothermal effect. First of all, in our Kochel nanoparticles, light is absorbed by titanium core. It absorbs UV, visible, and near-infrared light, and also by titanium oxide. Titanium oxide can absorb the UV light. After absorption, and due to the Landau damping mechanism, we can produce hole and electrons, and separation of hole and electrons occur by accumulation of the electrons in titanium core and the hole in titanium oxide shell. After that, the effect of temperature most probably is due to the diffusion of intermediates at the catalyst surface. Or also we can suggest the effect of some dynamics of water absorbed at the surface of the catalyst, since we absorb hydrogen without glycerol. And also we cannot exclude the effect of temperature on the charge transfer. It should be a subject of the further studies of mechanism with these particles. In conclusions, I would like to thank my colleagues from ECSM, also my colleagues from University of Montpellier, and Cellule Energie of French CNRS for support of this work. And thank you for your attention.